Kebi, buongiorno a tutti e a tutte, vi ringrazio per essere qui così numerosi, ma dico solo due parole per ringraziare a nome di tutti Giorgio Parisi che ci ha fatto il grande onore di venire questi 2 giorni a Padova. Ovviamente, come potete immaginare, è impegnatissimo, ma ha accettato con piacere il nostro invito. Ecco, si fermerà per poco, quindi dopo il seminario ci sarà forse la possibilità di salutarlo brevemente, ma no, non garantisco. Ecco, quindi adesso procediamo con la parte scientifica e lascio la parola alla professoressa Bernardini della commissione per i colloqui a che introduce Giorgio Parisi.
Okay, grazie mille. Okay, it's a great pleasure and a great honor for me today to welcome you to the colloquium of Professor Giorgio Parisi. He is a highly renowned scientist, and his reputation is actually very broad in the media for his sympathy as well as for his really rare authenticity. But actually, it's quite remarkable the influence that he's having on society in growing the awareness on the importance of science, research, and education, as well as for his broad civil and social commitments that go well beyond what I'm saying here. But he's certainly very known in the international scientific landscape for a high number of breakthrough ideas and highly acknowledged achievements in several areas of physical sciences and well beyond. So Giorgio Parisi is Professor Emeritus of Theoretical Physics of Fundamental Interactions at Sapienza University of Rome and member and former president of the Lincei Academy. He is actually a member of National Academy of Sciences and Philosophies in several countries. He studied at Sapienza University in Rome, where he graduated in 1970, working on the Higgs boson. And his mentor was Nicola Cabibbo, that is a brilliant and charismatic physicist in the theory of fundamental interactions. After graduating, Giorgio Parisi has been a researcher at several institutions in Italy, and later spent long periods of research abroad from the US to France and finally at CERN, before coming back to Italy, where he became full professor for theoretical physics in 1981, that is just 11 years after his graduation. Throughout his scientific career, Giorgio Parisi has made many decisive and widely acknowledged contributions in different areas of physics, starting from particle physics. Let's just recall the very famous Altarelli-Parisi equation in non-equilibrium quantum chromodynamics. He later contributed to statistical mechanics, fluid dynamics, condensed matter, supercomputer sciences, and well beyond. He has written articles on neural networks, immune systems, and collective movements of birds, inspiring many researchers in biology and medicine as well. And he is author of more than 700 articles and 4 books. He has actually been awarded 2 research grants of the European Research Council in the form of advanced grants. Now, the list of prestigious recognition is very long. I wouldn't even try that. Just starting 16 years after he graduated, let me just mention the Boltzmann Medal, the Dirac Medal, the Onsanger Prize, the Wolf Prize, and last but certainly not least, the Nobel Prize in Physics for the discovery of the interplay of disorder and fluctuations in physical systems from atomic to planetary scales. I found remarkable that an asteroid has been named after him. So in February 2022, the asteroid 15803, which was discovered in 1994, has been named after him, 15803 Parisi. And today, Professor Parisi will guide us through the mysteries and fascinations of the theory of complex systems and the role of multiple equilibrium states in complex systems. Thank you very much and enjoy.
Okay. So, thank you very much for this nice introduction. As you can understand, I could speak on many subjects related to also to the Nobel Prize, but I decide to concentrate on one key point of the theory that was done for related to complex system, and the idea is multiple equilibrio. Now the okay, let me say something, that the idea of multiple equilibria, it was quite old, not quite old, but appeared in the 70s, in the end of the 60s and in the 70s in many type of discipline. Now, the first example is the theory of Eldredge, nice Eldredge and Steve Gould, on the theory of punctuated equilibrium. Now, the idea is was very simple, and the idea that was like, for example, for the evolution of horses, was that you start from horse, that the original horse are very small, like a fox terrier, something. And after the horse becomes gradually bigger, and in the process of the horses to become bigger, we arrive to the horses of today. But it was, if you want, something like a gradual process in which you could say that the horses gain 10 centimeters for a million years. And this is a gradualist, that therefore you have a gradual selection in which you have a bigger horses that are selected with respect to small horses, and you have this kind of behavior. Now, this was a conversation in which, of course, during this evolution of horses, you get horses that at a certain moment you call just because you have evolution, you have a change of DNA. This change of DNA makes that horses with small horses and big horses cannot be crossed. They don't have a fertile descendant, and therefore they belong to different species. Now the idea was the average Gould was quite different, that you have a process in which you have a long time period in which nothing happens, at least at the level of phenotype, or what you can see at the level of the remnant. Of course, at the level of DNA, at the level of genotype, there could be evolution, but you have a long period that for respect to the characteristic of the body, nothing happens, and you may have a certain moment, a very fast change to the creation of a new species. This may happen in different way. It may be that you have something like allopatric speciation, in which there is the creation of new species in a small region, and after that in a particular environment, and the new species that is created in a particular environment at a certain point gain some fitness advantage with the old one and invades all the territory of the old one. If you want, it's not the language that you can, they were using, but you can think of the species live in a fitness landscape. The species is something like a stationary point in this fitness landscape, is locally a minimum. Because if you change a few things, you don't gain, but it may have some kind of like a statistical tunnel, a tunnel from one minimum, from one DNA that is well, a phenotype that is well fitted to another phenotype who is well fitted, crossing some region on non-fitness phenotype, but you can cross for a short time. And therefore you have this idea that you have a very long period of stasis that are punctuated by regions of fast evolutionary change. Therefore, from the viewpoint of physicists, you can think of a system in a minimum thermal fluctuation, some kind of fluctuation which make the system tunnel to another minimum. Now, there was a theory of memory. The theory of memory started essentially with a work of Hebb about, I think, in 1943. After there was the way, this was formalized in formula by the work of Hofield in 82. There was a lot of work of Amit and his collaborators, Amit, whose friend is Somponinsky. And the idea is, of course, there was some discussions with Caglianello and so on in Italy between Hepp and Hofield, and the idea how memory of the mammal memory works. Now the things, vertebrate, chordate works because the memory of a chicken is not very different in of the memory of mammals. And the idea is not vertebrate, the things are completely different. In the nervous system, a non-vertebrate is completely different from the system of vertebrate. And now the idea is essentially the following. If you think of the brain, there is some part where the memory is localized, and the typical activity of of a neuron, the time in which the neuron may change, typically the neurons become active with a typical distance of 30-40 milliseconds. So the typical activity of the neuron is 40 milliseconds, and therefore the brain, the memory, when your memory is active, you actually remember something. For example, I show you a pen, I ask to think if the pen is up or down, because after 5-10 seconds you have to answer to this question, pressing a button. You may think up for 5 seconds, 10 seconds, and this corresponds that your brain system of memory is more or less stays in some state which is go on for 5-10 seconds and more, and therefore it goes on for a very longer time. The typical change of memories the memory state where you don't remember, and therefore also in this case you may think of the system says in some kind of equilibrium, and it may jump from one equilibrium to another equilibrium point, each possible equilibrium point corresponds to something that you memorize. Of course, this may happen because the interactions between the neuron are such that when you memorize something, you create one possible new equilibrium state, and you have a system which have a very large set of equilibrium states. And now the things that you can, the fact that you may memorize a very large number of objects, or the billions, maybe more, are difficult to count how many is the memory span that you may have, it corresponds to the fact that you have a very large number of equilibrium states. Now, for example, if you take a complex system, they have a long period of, the idea therefore you may have a long period of nearly equilibrium that are separated by fast transitions. Now, if you look at geological era, forgetting also the possible external event like asteroids and so on, you know that you have a long, there's classification to Triassic, Jurassic and so on. You have essentially some kind of flora, fauna, and a kind of atmosphere composition that goes on with small change gradually. But you have one moment that is very fast, that you go to one period to another period, and things are going to change quite fast. Therefore, you can think of these things as a kind of different possible equilibria. Now, the similar For example, similar ideas were put forward by Goldstein in 1969 to understand the physics of glasses. The idea that if you take a glass, also in this case, the glass may have a large number of equilibria characterized by different positions, atoms. The glass are amorphous and not crystalline. Therefore, what happens is that you may have atoms in different ways, and you may, the idea that you may have, when you have the glass is still in somewhat semi-liquid situation, like a higher temperature, which have a viscosity which is 10 to the 10 times higher than the standard liquid, that the glass, say, the atom of the glass may jump by tunneling from one minimum configuration to another minimum configuration. And that is going to explain, and there is a theory that was put forward by Goldstein to use these ideas to explain some of the peculiar properties of the glasses. It was amusing that the word multiple equilibria was a concept that was well known from people doing economics. For example, there was a paper by De Broglie that wrote a paper in 1970, he got the Nobel Prize, Economics with a Finite Set of Equilibria. And he was interested to show that some kind of mathematical equation or models that were describing the economics have only a finite set of solutions and not an infinite set of solutions. What I find more amusing that in the for the Nobel Prize of Economics in 2022, last year, the Nobel Prize in Economics made a lecture with the title Multiple Equilibria, which is the same of this one. So this is nowadays, but the idea that in the 70s there was this idea. And also the idea that was going on was what you can call of a corrugated landscape, a rough landscape. This landscape is usually is a function or is, which stays defined on a multiple dimensional space, because if you think, so for example, the landscape of a given phenotype, the landscape of a given genotype, the space of genotype in a very large dimensional space, but normally you may have some picture of, say, that you have a landscape in which have many minimum and so on. The landscape may correspond to the risk as function of the configuration, financial risk or fitness, energy, cost, or something like that. And you can think that the system try to stay in the minimum of this landscape. And of course, therefore, however, there are some fluctuation. So the system may move. So for example, here, it just moves inside the minimum. Here, may do something like a tunneling from one minimum to another minimum. Or you may have a situation where you have a narrow valley and go from one minimum to another minimum crossing a narrow valley. Okay, therefore, this idea. This was something that was common, but how do you... The problem was how you construct how do you construct a statistical model, I mean some kind of mathematics, some kind of tools to discuss a system which have a number equilibrium, which is the tool that you start to discuss the form of the landscape and so on and so on. And the things that, starting from the hints that are giving you, the need of doing these things here, it was not clear how to go in that direction. And also What it was very clear that Goldstein, I think, did not know the work of Gould. Gould did not know the work of Goldstein. Nobody knows the work of economics, economists apart economists, and so on and so on. Now, the thing that was important from the viewpoint came from something which does not seem to have nothing to do with multiple equilibrium. Now, which are the people were doing alloys of gold and iron with different percentage and studying the behavior of the system. Now, why people started to do the study of this alloy? This alloy with a small amount of iron, for example, here in the graph from 1% to 8%. The idea was essentially the following. People were interested to study the magnetic property of iron, but iron normally interacts with the other iron that are nearby. So what you get if you do magnetic study of iron material, you get the things is quite complex because you have to take care of the interaction between one atom of iron and another type of iron. However, the idea was very simple. Let's say, in order to understand better characterize the interaction, understand the effect on the interaction atoms of iron with themselves, if we can study the behavior of a single atom of iron, we can understand which is the magnetic property of single atom of iron, and on the top, and therefore we can fortify our theory comparing with the behavior of single atom with the theoretical prediction. After we, on the top of that, or also maybe in a phenomenological way, we can then add the interaction of different atoms, iron. Of course, if you put only one iron, atom of iron in the vacuum, suspended in the vacuum, you don't get anything interesting because the amount of atom iron should be macroscopically. So the idea was the following. Well, we do an alloy. We take the atom of gold that are not magnetic, and we take an alloy of 1%, for example, of iron inside the matrix of gold. Now the thing that was the idea was that the 8 atoms of gold, not being magnetic, would leave the atoms of iron separated one from the other one. However, this was the original idea, but unfortunately, depending from the viewpoint, this is something that did not happen. Because this is the typical, we are interested in magnetic system. Now, when we do a magnetic system, we can look to the magnetic susceptibility, for example, zero field, as function of the temperature. And for a magnetic system, you would get that the magnetic susceptibility increase, and when the system becomes ferromagnetic, it will become infinite, because what happens is just a very small magnetic field does magnetize the system. If you have suppose, however, that you have an antiferromagnetic system, I mean a system, for example, that orders, but that's the order state does not point into the direction of the external magnetic field, what happens is that at high temperature the system respond more and more to the external field when you decrease the temperature. That easy to understand because if you do the first order response, the first order response is proportional to beta, the inverse of the temperature of the magnetic field. So you have this behavior of the type. For antiferromagnetic system, you have a peak that signals the presence of some order, and after you have a typical behavior. So this typical behavior that was at 8% of iron, means that the iron do not have some interaction, that strong interaction among themselves, so they do not form, cannot form a ferromagnetic system, but they have some residual interaction that is mediated by the atom or by the atom of gold. Therefore, you can think of atom iron that are at two atomic distance. At two atomic distance, I mean, I think that you know, but it's important to stress that ferromagnetism is something that is usually related to the fact that the wave of the electrons around one atom superposes with the wave of electrons around the other atom, and therefore this magnetic interaction in reality is an electric interaction due to the superposition of the waves of one atom with the other one. When, according to standard theory, just if you take to the older standard theory, two atoms at two atomic distance, the overlap between the direct overlap of the atomic of the wave function of one atom and the other one is very small, and you may think the distance to you may have some residual interaction between the atoms, and this leads to some kind of ferromagnetism. However, the thing that was a surprise is that when you were decreasing the strength, the concentration, the phenomena was very similar, and the only things that were happening that you were going, everything was very similar. The only difference is that everything was shifted to low temperature. This is a 2%, this is 1%. So you remain with something like a sharp peak that signals some kind of transition, and the transition will not going to disappear. And there was some head scratching to understand this type of behavior, and what people realized that the things could be explained in principle quite easily, the dependence of this transition from the concentration, but just by noticing that what was happening, that the atoms of iron were deforming the gold surface, the Fermi surface of the atoms of gold. Now, because if one, the Fermi surface, this deformation of the Fermi surface induces some long-range interaction, and the final effect of the interaction was something that was decreasing like a power. And the other thing that was interesting, that this type of interaction was very fastly oscillating with the distance. Now, just because the distance of iron in magnetic inside the matrix of gold were random, you would say that the interaction between the atoms iron was essentially random, and the thing that was interesting that there is this transition that essentially all the properties that you look near this point, this point, is something that they do not really change, anything does not change. So the typical experiments were done with higher concentration iron because the signal, the magnetic signal is right. So, however, apart from this understanding how there is this scale in temperature, the point was to understand better the property at this transition point, and also to understand what was happening in the low temperature state. Now, there was a lot. This experiment, as you see, is 71. This experiment is quite very interesting because the people were starting to look on to spin glasses from the 60s. However, the experiment was very important for the following point. The use of the experiment were done at quite somewhat higher magnetic field, and instead of seeing a sharp peak were seen around the peak. And however, what these people, Cannella, Midas, Badnik, discovered that the fact that the peak was rounded was due to the fact that people were using a somewhat huge, not huge, large magnetic field, but I mean they were using a magnetic field of 100 gauss, which is not very large at all. But if they were using the ferromagnetic with the experiment with a much smaller field, although the one gauss, and that probably could be done using a squid as the fact that you could do, I think that you could do this type of experiment was due to the fact that squid was discovered, people were able to see this peak, so there was this notion of a sharp transition. This was quite false. The name Spinglass was already existed in the 60s, and the people called Spinglass because they believed that there was no transition. Like also for real glasses, you don't see, you just see some kind of cooling without a sharp transition. So Spinglass had the meaning of a magnetic system without a sharp transition. However, 10 years after the name was given, the people found a sharp transition, but the name was so used that they did not retract the name. And after a certain time, Edward Anderson is a P.W. Anderson that took the Nobel Prize in 78 or something like that for localization, proposed to a very simple Hamiltonian to describe the system. The Hamiltonian is quite simple because you have some spins that you may take or to be Ising spin, which are plus minus one. I've written for Ising spin, but you can put Heisenberg spin, in which the spins are a vector, and you have one term that is very easy to understand, that the term magnetic field where push the spins in all the direction, and the idea that the spin are defined on a lattice that you can take for your simplicity as a cubic lattice, but the lattice is not very important. The Kappen constant differs from zero only at the point nearest neighbor. Therefore, if you take all h I k equal to 1, this will be the standard easy model. And the difference was that that in this case, you have this coupling a random choice. Therefore, a choice in a random way, and there's someone are positive, someone are negative, and the average, the statistical value, or essentially all the one, these things here, but are taken in a random way. Now, this was something that typically was done in that years, that you know people were know that there were solid systems that were disordered, they have some kind of quenched disorder. Why you say quenched disorder? Well, the point was the following, that the alloy, is typical alloy, is produced as 1,000 Celsius. And after the alloy is produced, you cool the system. The experiments are done to a few tens of 10, 20 Kelvin. And what happens is that at 10, 20 Kelvin, the atoms are completely frozen. You don't certainly move the atoms of iron and gold around at 10 Kelvin. Therefore, the position of the atom of iron inside the matrix of gold is frozen, and therefore you have this J as some kind of random parameter that are frozen, and therefore one say that this are quenched the parameter, and this Hamiltonian is the Hamiltonian which is J quenched. The word quenched is also used for lattice case theory, when where the gauge field are frozen with respect to the fermions, and the origin is essentially the same. Indeed, it was taken from spin glass. Now, Edward Anderson made a very interesting observation. He said, well, but now that I have this Hamiltonian, what should I compute with this Hamiltonian? Which are the quantities that I would like? Of course, you can say that I can compute the free energy, fine. But apart from the free energy, what can I compute? I can compute the magnetization, but the magnetization is no spontaneous magnetization because the J are random. Of course, there is some local magnetization. In each point, you may expect that you are low temperature, you expect the system freeze, and therefore you may have the system, the MI, the spins, acquire spontaneous magnetization. But the spontaneous magnetization will be different from point to point. And of course, this is clearly that you are not interested in that for many, many reasons, apart from one that you are interested to do the analytic. If you want to do analytic computation, you want to do analytic computation the infinite volume limit, and you don't an infinite volume limit, and you don't want to compute an infinite number of local magnetization and so on. So the idea that instead of looking to the magnetization, single magnetization, you can look to the average square of the magnetization square. So for it's a magnetization average at zero, the average square is different from zero, and therefore you can define this object Q, which is the average of the square of the magnetization, and this is normally called QEA, because it was not their proposal to call this way, but other people call EA for Edward and Anderson. So you can say that I have a situation where at higher temperature, the magnetization is zero and QEA is equal to zero, at lower temperature QA is different from zero. So far, so good, nothing, and therefore the peak corresponding to a transition where you start you start to having a QA different from zero. Okay. Now, they also introduced the last version of the replica method, because the replica method was used also in other contexts. Essentially, the problem is the following, that if you want to do analytic computation, the typical thing that you do in analytic computation, you compute the partition function of the system. The partition function of the system, you can look to the books, is just the sum over the configuration of exponential or H or the Hamiltonian or these things here. And after what you have to do, you for each given sample, you compute the partition function. After you have the free energy, which or beta free energy minus beta free energy is the log of the partition function, and you have to do the average of the partition function over all possible j. Now, the partition function is essentially H is done in the following way, and therefore you have exponential H is in the partition function. JH are distributed in a Gaussian way, and you can think that you can integrate over the J that are Gaussian. However, there is a problem. Sorry. Okay. There is a problem that there is this log here. Now, just it's clearly that the average of the log is not the log of the average, and therefore the point that is you like to take out the log, but the log is essential, and you cannot remove the log. But you can do what Anderson himself was calling Outrageous trick. Essentially, the thing that you can say, well, suppose that instead of having the log, here I put Z to the N. Z to Zn is a product of n factor Zj, and now if Zj is something like a Gaussian, it's exponential minus J. Therefore, in this case, I can do explicitly the integral over J, and we get some exact formula that involves the integral of certain number or just a finite number of variable. Anyway, you don't want to okay, so far so good, but you don't want the average of Zn, you want the average of the log. Now, the observation that you can say, well, but the log is the limit n go to zero of z to the n, the derivative of z to the n done respect to n, and you do the limit n to zero. Now, this is clearly that this is the, so for the following. Well, first we compute these things here, writing zn as a product of n factor. After that you do this way, you use this formula and you arrive to the log. However, it's clearly that one is, there is a small problem that one is somewhat, we are cheating because in this formula here, we have n must be an integer number. And also you see that just because you arrive to an integral over this number of variable, it's clear that also the number of variables which you integrate should be an integer number of variables. But however, in this formula here, n must go to zero, and therefore this is a non-integer number of variables. Now, the idea, this was some kind of manipulation that were used at that time. For example, later on in large-scale theory, using the number of fermion species equal to zero, and after you can do extrapolation in n, derivative respect to n, it's clear the number of fermion species must be cannot be a continuous number, but if you use in the formula, you can see that you can do. So the idea is that, well, if in some sense, if we compute this quantity here for integer n, and have a specific formula, I can after do the computation of these things going to n equal to zero and at the time the log. This was something that, the idea is quite old. Suppose that you want, I think that everybody here knows that the square root of a number is also said that you elevate the number to the power 1/2. Of course, if you define the elevation to the power to the power n, saying that you write a number n times and you do the product of all these numbers, it's clear that elevating to the power 1/2 does not make sense. However, to declare that the number elevated to the power 1/2 is the square root is something that is perfectly consistent with all formal properties of the elevation to the power. This observation, by the way, was done by Nicola d'Osesme around 1350, on which he discovered invented this idea that the square root is the power to 1/2. However, coming back to Shervington, to the theory, the model Edward Anderson was a model that was defined on a finite dimensional system, but it was not possible to study the model on a finite dimensional system exactly, because we know that also the ACML model you cannot compute. So Shervington Kirkpatrick had the idea of defining some kind of Hamiltonian, simplify the model in which you say, well, you take, we disregard all the finite dimensional effect, we disregard the lattice, we have just a certain number of points. On each point we have a spin that is plus or minus one. All points are connected one over them. The coupling between one over a coupling of the point is Gaussian with a square root with variance 1 over n. So each of these terms is small. However, we have n squared of this kind of term, and you can study what happens in the n go to infinity. Now, typically what happens in many, many cases in statistical mechanics that putting a weak interaction between an infinite number of objects gives a statistical model that is soluble, and one can show in different ways that is something kind of a mean field theory of the model. For example, one can, and this is a typical thing that was do in some way for ferromagnet and so on. The problem is, therefore, the final thing that was proved by Sherrington and Kirkpatrick was that you can write an exact formula for z to the n as an integral the q of some function f of q, where Q are some n by n matrices that are symmetric with zero diagonal elements. Now, once that you have this formula here, they say, well, when just because I have a big N here, when big N here is large, you use the set of point, the point of maximum or Laplace, or minimum if you want, and you have one point that is dominated the integral, apart from small terms that are not exponential in larger n, because we want to, at the end to compute the free energy, we want to take the log of this object here, these things will give them dominated by one particular point. Now, Sherrington and Kirkpatrick made the extra looking assumption that these things was dominated by the set of point where all non-matrix element, non-diagonal, because I had to take non-zero element, the diagonal element fixed to zero are equal to Q. And the typical things that happened that after they found, they did the computation, they found a perfectly looking computation, a nice peak of the susceptibility and so on, but the things that after they did also the computation of the entropy was changing sign at lower temperature and was becoming, it was something like minus 0.17, 1 over 2 pi, something like that, at zero temperature. Now, the entropy of this model is just defined in some way, it just counts the number of states, and therefore the entropy of the model cannot be negative. So it's clear that there was some kind of computation and some problem with the computation. One problem with the computation would say, well, I'm not taking the minimum of these things, and they're made at Tauless. Tauless is the same Tauless we got in the Nobel Prize in 2016, I guess. Proved that these things is not a minimum. And first of all, the one could ask what you mean exactly that the function f is a minimum. Well, the definition essentially is the following. If you look just to a function, suppose that I take trace of q square. Trace of q square is some a b q square to the a. Now, the things that you would like to natural to say that the minimum of these things is a q equal to zero, just like a parabola. Now, if you look to these things as function, you take all the q, a b equal to a constant, and you just compute, well, each element is equal to q squared, and the number of elements is equal to n minus 1. To make, if of course you can remove this factor, you want to compute these things, the limit n go to zero, you divide the factor 1 of n, and you find that the limit equal to zero, this function is equal to minus q squared. Now, it's clear that if you look to this function as function of the parameter, it's not a q equal to zero, it's not the minimum, but it's a maximum. But however, the number of parameters here is a negative number of parameters. So the final decision that was taken that the definition of minimum means that the axiom matrix, that the matrix of the second derivative should be non-negative. If you find a negative eigenvalue, this is not a minimum. If all eigenvalues are positive, it's a minimum. If there's one eigenvalue that is zero, you have to discuss and so on. So there, first of all, there was this type of definition. Okay. Now the people started to look to find. Okay, they made a table that said that Q equal to a constant is not a minimum, is not good, but also because it gives the wrong result. But this did not give a hint which form of the matrix is taken. Now, the thing that was started by many people start to play with these things. For example, if Q is not F all the same value, let's start to try with some matrix Q which have two different values. This is the simplest things. So how you can, one idea where let's say we divide the system in blocks of two objects or two spins, therefore Q12, Q24, Q56 have one value, and all other objects have all different values. So for example, these things here become this kind of expression over there. People started to do computation that way. And what happened that for finite value of m, nothing, the entropy was still negative, but it was the situation where m was going to infinity removed the problem, so m equal to infinity with this scheme could be a reasonable way to do, but one knew from numerical simulations that the energy was wrong. I mean, the energy of the model does not depend from the value of m, and simulation gave a value of the energy where that was 5 or 6 standard deviation from the value of that one. So these things did not work. So once you have, you can do notice the following things, that if you look to this quantity here, let's put a minus sign in order to make these things here, is 1 minus mq1 square plus mq0 square. I mean, this number just counts the number of a line, but any getter you get this formula. Now, it's clearly that it's quite strange that if you take m equal to 2, this will be positive and this will be negative. And you may be disturbed by the fact that one parameter is positive, one parameter is negative. Now, you clearly understand that if you take m between 0 and 1, both this term here is positive and this term is positive. So then here you say, well, maybe I can take instead of grouping the replicas in a number of 2 replicas, 3 replicas together, I can take, for example, can group the replicas in groups of half a replica, and it's clear that this does not make sense. But however, you can write the formula formula here in this way, and you say that you do the derivative, and finally, I will choose m, just imposing the derivative respect to m is equal to 0. It's clear that the procedure does not make sense when m is non-integer, in the same way that you can ask which is to design a polygon with 3.5 sides. It's clear that this does not make sense. Of course, you can compute the circumference. Suppose that you have a circumference, you can prove this formula for the circumference of a polygon radius 1. If I not made a mistake with algebra, this is the formula. In the limit n go to infinity, this going to 2 pi. And of course, you discover that if the number of sides, for example, is 2/3, you get a negative number and so on. Of course, it's clear that the formula makes sense, but the object to which you have computed the circumference does not make sense. Anyhow, what happens at the if you do this approach, you get the energy, everything is, nearly everything is good. But instead of having energy which is -0.17, you have nearly okay, the entropy is nearly zero, slightly negative, but nearly zero. Okay, now next step, what you do? You say, well, I have to go back in this direction. You take, instead of dividing the group of system group of M1 replica, we further divide this group of M1 replica in group of M2 replicas, but with M2 greater than M1. So, which is not a standard thing, because if you have an object, you divide the n object in groups with smaller number object. And now you do these things. Now, just because you go this procedure an infinite number of times, and after you arrive to a solution where the function qx is a parameter which is defined the integral 0, 1, and the final formula are something quite reasonable. Not reasonable, I mean, at the end, when you write a final formula, there is just a respectable mathematics. There's not craziness, there's not on. You have some functional, a functional set of parameter here. The functional is not simple because it contains some auxiliary function. You have to solve this differential equation that depends on this on this function qx, and after all you have this parameter, and you say that you have to maximize this function here as function qx. This is a very well respectable mathematics with a certain under certain condition you could prove. It was proved that 40 years later that the solution of this equation are unique. And you get the respect of mathematics. Now, if you look to these things, what happens has these things to do with complexity? When what happened that after looking to all these ideas, to these things, that you start and one start to look analytically what are the implications, solutions, and so on. One discovered that the meaning of the probabilistic interpretation solution, that the system had many equilibria states, and each equilibrium state have some kind of entered in the Gibbs probability with a certain weight. They were characterized by certain magnetization that were depending on the state. And you could therefore define a certain overlap between what happens in a state A, in state alpha, and a state gamma, this characterized state gamma, and you have all this type of object that enters in the theory. And now this means that the model has the property that the model has this kind of properties, and therefore all this problem of breaking of using this very strange form of the matrix Q, at the end, after some analysis that took a few years, corresponds to the fact that you have many states. Now, these many states can be classified in different ways and so on and so on. But however, this is something that was, therefore, what happened that all this time, that just by chance, because people were not looking to complex system, it turned out that these plain glasses were the first complex system that was discovered in a standard statistical mechanics. And one thing that was quite peculiar is the number of states of this system. Of course, at the infinite volume limit, we're also going to infinity. So the structure was not only a complex system characterized by 2 or 3 or 5 or 11 equilibrium states, but it was the number of states were going to infinity. Of course, this was Okay, this was something that came from the mathematical formula, but the formula that one was using were clearly where one making some ad hoc assumption in the probabilistic approach, or there were frank nonsense in many intermediate steps. So it was not clear if the solutions that I wrote here, I wrote before, were correct. For example, the expression for the free energy. And at the end of the game, there were many types of contribution. For example, the contribution of Francisco Guerra introduced at the end of the 90s some new ideas in the field. And finally, the correctness of the previous formula for the free energy was proved by Talagrande in 2001. So the formula that was for the previous formula are correct, is a theorem, and also the details of the details were just proved by Perchenko in 2013. So the first proof of Guerra of Talagrande was quite complex. And there is now a relatively simple proof by Panchenko and so on. Now, just to make a comparison of the theory with the experiment, and the things that you can do is the following. You can do, well, the first of all, people were let me say the following. Suppose that I want to measure the magnetic susceptibility. I want to measure the response of the system to adding a magnetic field. Now, if I take the system and I stay the system at magnetic, a small temperature, the system is below the critical temperature, I add a magnetic field. However, when I add the magnetic field, what happens to the system remains in the same state of zero magnetic field. I mean, it will adapt locally, but it will not make a tunneling and jump into another equilibrium state. And therefore, just if I took this measurement at low measurement of the susceptibility at low temperature, which is the linear response susceptibility, I mean, just as you do, you add some magnetic field and you see how the system responds to this magnetic field, you measure something that is called the linear response susceptibility, however, where the system cannot jump from the one equilibrium state to another equilibrium state. Now, if you add the system at high temperature and cool the system, what happens to the system? The field is always there, and therefore what I can, the system is quite likely that will go to the equilibrium state that corresponds to the equilibrium state in the field. And now this is the field cooler susceptibility. One of the things that was quite peculiar of spin glasses, it was that if you look to these things, to these things here, which have this sharp peak, there is a sharp peak that was shown before. This is the field cooler, this is the linear response susceptibility, because the thing that was much easier to measure, because you put an alternate field at a function of the temperature, you look to the response of the magnetization. And this has a peak. If you do the zero field susceptibility, the zero field susceptibility of course coincide with the other one at high temperature and has completely different behavior. It essentially has a very minor peak and is essentially flat as function of the temperature. So you see that this was also one of the characteristics that was particularly puzzling for the experimental point of view, because they were saying that arriving at the same point from different paths, you obtain an effect that was different by also a factor two. It was not a minor thing, and also these things was obtaining you and adding a very small magnetic field, for example, not on one Tesla, but a magnetic field of one Gauss, I mean a very small magnetic field, and that one ghost to ghost will make not a difference. And now if you do the same things theoretically, you get that this is the theoretical prediction already in field of the linear response susceptibility, which have a peak here, while the field course susceptibility is arrived to a peak and is from the peak here something flat. Of course, it's clearly that this, especially the tails here near the critical point, are different from here. But one has to realize that this is a mean field computation that is the result, if you want, with large dimension and so on. And this is the experimental situation. So you see that already at this type of level, you people is going to obtain something that is a very good in a qualitative agreement with the experiment. And that was quite clear. Well, I put these things on 1998 because it was a very clear experiment, but these things was evident already from the beginning that the difference between field cooled and non-field cooled behavior. So let me jump to the end of the seminar. I think I have 5 minutes. Okay, now the idea that this theory of spin glasses was always a P.W. Anderson, they described the spin glass as an amazing cornucopia. He wrote, think, 7 paper on physics today describing spin glasses. And he says that things, the K result, is a beautiful revelation, the structure of the random rugged landscape, the landscape that stays in many complex optimization. And he says the specific spin glasses and SK model are only a jumping off point for an amazing cornucopia of wide ranging application of the same kind of thinking. So Anderson realized that this idea were not only restricted to the problem of spin glasses, and for example, there have been many developments in physics. Developments in physics were connected to the to some kind of slow dynamics aging, some modification of fluctuation dissipation. That was all applied to structural glasses. One very important point was the study of jamming for R-sphere, also interface, heteropolymer folding and so on. There were a lot of development outside physics. For example, development outside physics. And there were artificial neural networks where used the spin glasses. There was a computation, the capacity of associative memory. There was a lot of discussion on learning generalization to neurobiology. This on the biological side. Also on optimization and computer science, the idea of simulated annealing came out in this kind of theory. Of spin glasses. There was all problem of random optimization problem like travel salesman matching, constraint, and a lot of things of this type. So there was a lot of applications to many different disciplines, and the idea was very fertile, and therefore it gave a lot of this idea of multiple equilibrium. Once that you have a good formula to treat on, it went applied to many, many different situations. And I think that I finish here. I want also to give a big thank to the people that I was lucky to work with. And this is a list of done in 2018. There's an updated one, but was not finding it. And these are the list of 317 people which I was lucky to work with. And it's not a continuous, but the size of the name is roughly proportional to the number of papers that we wrote together. Amos should be somewhere there, but I cannot, I do not notice where. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, time for questions, especially from students.
Thank you. So first of all, thank you for the interesting talk. Working? Okay. I was wondering, when we are talking about equilibria, and especially we are drawing connection with economics, I can't help but think about the equilibrium concept in game theory. So I wish to ask, are there some examples of cross-fertilization between spin-glass theory and game theory, especially with regards of the concept of equilibrium? Thank you.
Well, this is something that I not worked with, but there was the same paper, I think, also by Andrea Cavagna, and I think by Merv Seely, on the relation between Cavagna is a 90s, and Merv Seely, and Matteo Merv Seely of CISA, been worked on connection with game theory and spin glass theory. For example, There was a lot of things, and the last paper of Matteo are very nice, but I not the time to study at length. But I mean, one thing that I'm using the work equilibrium is something that may be not restricted to system which satisfy Boltzmann-Gibbs mechanics. You may have also something with equilibrium in system which have slightly different situation than not Boltzmann-Gibbs in certain case.
More comments, questions?
I'm very impressed, we're all very impressed by your great ability of contributing very important ways to many different fields of physics. And this is a great contrast to some types of very specialized theorists. So you're a peculiar class of 40 classes in Italian of physicists. Is there any characteristic of your personality that you would find that explains this ability, besides your mathematical prowess? Is it curiosity?
Well, in some sense, the things that happened, that just after my thesis, I did a thesis on high energy physics, and after that I was interested essentially to the part of model, to deep inelastic model, and therefore I have to knew the, all this, there was all the problem of understanding a strong, some interaction that at that time was considered to be strong. It was not clear that the theory was asymptotically free. And what I discovered that because my good friend Luca Pelliti and Marco Derma were doing a thesis with Di Casso and Gianni Ionella Senior. Gianni Ionella Senior, I think, was a professor in Padova at that time, but he was having students also in Rome. That the problem of phase transition was a problem that was connected to some kind of interactions that were scale invariant and strong interactions. And therefore, it was in the same kind of general framework of the problems that we have in quantum field theory. Indeed, they suggested to use the Jevons normalization group, the normalization group which at the time 11 in the last chapter of Bjork and Drell, that was a typical books of electrodynamics. So the fact that I just started to move from partially to understand, I knew that the things that was impressed on me, if you want, that one can have a toolbox. And the toolbox that were developed at that time in high energy physics were used from statistical mechanics. And later on, and therefore the idea that coming from a different field into a new one, you can arrive to a new field carrying your toolbox that you have developed elsewhere, and that will be useful. Indeed, this happened many times ideas developed in one field were quite useful for different things. Therefore, just after my thesis, I became aware of this fact, and I think that this pushed for my mobility from one field to another. Because I had not to start again from scratch, but I was carrying my toolbox that every time was becoming larger and larger and heavier.
I was prompted by this question and by your answer to ask you another question. It's clear that interdisciplinarity is a great way of making big progress in science. What's the best way to form the young generations to be ready for interdisciplinarity? Give them a strong toolbox in a field to begin with, and then stimulate their curiosity to move to other fields, or start teaching a little bit of each field from the beginning, or some compromise between the two extremes?
Well, I don't know, but first of all, I don't have any precise idea on that, because I think that the result may depend strongly on the person. There are some people that I think that the thing that is important is to teach curiosity for the things that do not belong to essentially to your main field. Because the point is, one way is clearly that you have to master well some techniques. If you don't master well some techniques, it's clear that you cannot move to other field, Kevin. Therefore, you have to teach in some way that the techniques that are done from one field may be carried to another field. For example, one thing that was was Kreutz and Rebbe and others that discovered that the techniques that people were doing of molecular dynamics, Monte Carlo simulations, were useful for studying lattice gate theory and to study high energy physics. So this was something that could be done also I don't have any precise suggestion, but the fact to stress the fact I think that there is some similarities between what is done in one field and what is done in a field that is quite different.
So thank you for your very nice talk. You've been discussing about multiple equilibria. I would like to ask, when it comes to the computation, for instance, of the tunneling probability among these equilibria, is this computable? Is this conventional? Thank you. I mean, in this, for instance, in the spin glass case. Thank you.
Well, I think that many of the questions that one can ask about the structure of equilibrium, it could be understood in spin glass, especially for the static viewpoint. If you think of to understand, for example, other properties like the tunneling time between one equilibrium to another one, that is something that involves the dynamics, and the dynamics is something that is much more difficult. That you can understand something, but for the tunnel, but if you can especially understand what happened to the dynamics in some kind of adiabatic or quasi-adiabatic approximation. But for example, other things, for example, one thing that is not clear to me is the tunneling between one state to another state time is clearly that is exponentially large, but it is exponentially large as exponential n to one third, n to one quarter, is something that is much more difficult to be seen, because when the tunneling time is exponentially large, it's very difficult to measure. So, and also you don't have any precise analytic way. I mean, it's possible. It is possible to compute terms that are exponentially large, exponential n is very easy, no, it's possible. But exponential n to one third, exponential n to one half effect is something that is more difficult. I mean, there is some good evidence that the barrier between one minimum and another minimum is the edge of the barrier, it n to a non-integer power. There may be one, n is a number of spins, to one half or one third and so on, but usually the formalism that you're using well suited to compute to say that or it's exponentially large in n or it is all the exponential n to one half is something that is difficult to obtain. Therefore, that is something that for the moment we don't have a good theory.
So thank you for your talk. I had a question connecting to actually the examples you gave in the introductions, and you were mentioning phenotypes, brain states, and so on. So these seems to be very systems that are very different from the spin glasses, in the sense that, for example, even to exist, they have to consume energy. So rather than talking about equilibria, from a thermodynamic point of view, we are talking about known equilibria because there's a consistent energy input that has to be put in. What can we learn from spin glasses that we can apply also to these systems that are fundamentally different?
No, what you can learn certainly is the fact that the idea that you have it's clear that it's very difficult to do a direct application of a theory like spin glass to another theory. The point is the following, that if you think of complex system, each system has some kind of different way in which it is complex, so you cannot transcribe the result for another one. But looking at the metaphor, In a metaphoric way, what you can say, which is what not was written in Gould, that you can give this idea of the way that I presented it, that is different from there, that the species is some way of minimum in the fictional landscape, and they're going from one species to another species is something like a tunnel effect. And now this is something that I'm using as the welding of physics and so on as some kind of metaphor. And therefore, it's clear, and also metaphors are very important because it's the way that ideas go from one direction, from one part of the science to a different part of the science. For example, I was impressed by the when people discovered DNA, there was a metaphor that the cells, unlike a computer, the protein are the hardware and the DNA are the software. And you see also the idea of code is clearly that is taken from computer. The genetic code is a code like the software that you write on computer. So this was the idea that, of course, the metaphor is not correct at the end because there is some interaction between hardware and software and so on. But however, it was a very nice way to simplify it, to convey the ideas in a clear way, in some way, in the 50s, after what people realized that the DNA have some possible modifications, the exons, transposons, or some way to change and so on. They saw the problem of RNA, that's important. But I mean, it was a later refinement.
So thank you for the nice presentation. Now I was wondering, since you spoke about evolution of species and so on, you made the example of horses, and essentially you pointed out that instead of having a kind of smooth progression, there are this kind of steps which can take a long time to move to the next step. I was thinking if one can apply this to the largest possible system, the evolution of the universe, namely going to cosmology. In cosmology, as you know, essentially the evolution of the system that we call universe is related to breaking equilibrium states. For the description, generally we use the usual thermodynamics of the universe in early cosmology, for instance, the radiation era. I was wondering if this idea of multiple equilibria can have some impact also in describing the evolution of the universe, in particular in the early stage.
Well, you may think, I think that this may be some of these ideas may be relevant if you think so many very early universe before inflation and so on, because before you go from one equilibrium to another equilibrium when you have inflation, and you go in that case with a catastrophic way. But I mean, if you think, I mean, I'm not a very precise idea, but I mean, there are many people that speak of the landscape in string theory. In the landscape theory, string theory, you may have many different kind of evolution, many different kind of universes, and from you go from one universe to another universe by some kind of tunnel event. And however, it's clear that we do not have any experimental things for that very, very early time. And I think that also, well, inflation may say you may have something, but we still are not in the process of a fully understanding of the reasons of inflation. And that, but I think even the things on landscape theory, that something maybe can be done, but one should believe in landscape theory.
Thank you very much. Let me conclude now. Your list of appointments is long, as we know. Okay. So let's please all together thank Professor Parisi for being with us.
Grazie Giorgio.
Grazie a voi.
Spegnete il collegamento a Mondo Visione. Sì, la parte adesso deve essere solo per i presenti. Allora sai che nella nostra università ha molti anni e quindi si sono sviluppate molte tradizioni.
Lo so.
Ecco.